On this channel, I have built no end of Bluetooth speakers. I even managed to build one for only $1. That was an incredible video, by the way. You should check it out after watching this one. But all my Bluetooth speakers have one thing in common. I was trying to build them as cheaply as possible. This speaker, for example, I bought the cheapest Bluetooth speaker on the market and tried to upgrade it to make it sound better with no budget. But what would happen if I had no limit to budget and I just built the best Bluetooth speaker possible? Well, I have no idea, but I sure as hell want to find out. So come along and let's build it. Most people have used Bluetooth at some point in their lives. You may even be using it to listen to this video in the form of Bluetooth headphones or Bluetooth speakers. But not many people know how it works. Is it magic? Well, I'd forgive you for thinking that, but we're not in the 16th century and nobody's being burned at the stake for witchcraft. So this is not magic, it's super cool technology. But how does it work? Well, before we can look at that, we actually have to take a look further back towards radio waves and electromagnetic waves. The most common form of electromagnetic waves is, of course, light. We use it every day. In fact, all we can see is visible light. But if you have shorter or longer wavelengths, it's outside the visible spectrum, and these are used for basically everything, communications, Wi-Fi, cell phones, Bluetooth, even your microwave uses a form of electromagnetic waves. The question is, how can we use them to generate a sound signal? So they can literally be anything. But for this demonstration, let's think about only audio signals. In its simplest form, audio is vibrations in our eardrum. As our eardrum vibrates back and forth, the frequency basically tells our brain how to interpret it. There's a lot more to it than that, but that's all you need to know for now. So when we generate audio from, say, a speaker, we need to vibrate the air and cause compression waves, which will vibrate our eardrums at the correct frequency. So this is what an analog audio signal going down a wire would look like, with these top bits being when the speaker's at its furthest forward, and these bottom bits when the speaker's at its furthest back. And it vibrates in between them, generating sound. So how does a digital to analog converter work? There are two types of signals, analog and digital. Old radios like this one use analog signals, either through frequency modulation or amplitude modulation. But there's also digital signals. And how are they sent? Well, there are three ways, simply, you can send one. Through amplitude modulation, with short waves being zero, or low power waves being zero, and higher amplitude waves being one. You can also send it through frequency modulation or pulse width modulation. A short, say 1 nanosecond wave is zero. A 2 nanosecond wave, well, that's one. The third way, and possibly the worst way, is you can have an on-off signal. One is on, zero is off. All of these can send data in digital signals. And that allows your phone to communicate with a Bluetooth speaker. Your Bluetooth speaker then has a digital audio converter, or DAC, inside it, which can convert that digital signal, the ones and zeros, into real-time voltage positions for an analog signal. For the case of a Bluetooth speaker, you want something that can contain the sound and stop the two sound waves generated by the two sides of the speakers interfering with each other. Typically, something like this is used, a piece of plywood, but I don't think that's going to be enough for the ultimate Bluetooth speaker. So instead, I am going to build a case out of 2x4s. This will definitely make this the heaviest Bluetooth speaker of all time, but hopefully it will also make it one of the best sounding. 2x4s are a very unique material, so I wanted a very unique looking speaker. Designed in this half hexagon shape, I believe it's going to be one of the most unique speakers out there. After completing this outside frame, I began routing out a space for my speaker, which was easier said than done, as it had to be quite precise, and I'm still not very good with a router. Fortunately though, I did succeed and was able to secure my speaker in place using 4 screws. Now that we have a box with a speaker mounted in it, we can work on the internals. Now, the internals, we need a couple of things: a receiver, an amplifier, and some way of powering it. For the receiver, I'm actually going to be using a trick I learned from DIY Perks. If you take a high-end pair of wireless earphones and desolder the connection for the speaker, you can get a high-quality receiver on the cheap. Especially since a lot of the time the batteries die in these earphones and people are selling them off exceptionally cheap. As for the amplifier, I'm going to just be using one that I have lying around. This is a MOSFET amplifier, which are slightly nicer sounding, at least to my ears, than transistor amplifiers. But realistically, it's pretty clean and will give us quite a nice sounding boost. Now, final thing we need is somewhere powering it. And some of you may remember this. It's the power station I built a couple of videos ago. It still works 100%, but we are going to be disassembling it this video, because I need the charger and battery from it for this Bluetooth speaker. Upon pulling this apart, I was disappointed to discover that it still had the same awful quality charger that I put in it. Not really a surprise, but it was annoying re-realizing how bad the AliExpress charger really was. Enough complaining about that, let's move on to the earphones. I started by cutting off the speaker and then soldering the 2 wires to the input of the amplifier. It is important to note that you will need earphones that default to pushing both channels through a single earbud if only one is connected. Otherwise, you may lose the second stereo channel. Thanks to my amazing skills, I completely failed to film myself wiring it up because I'm bad at filming. Either way, this is the circuit diagram for how you want to wire it up. Be careful to use a DC to DC converter, which has a ground pass-through. Otherwise, you will create a short circuit doing it this way. If you don't have one with a ground-to-ground pass-through, you will need to wire it slightly differently, which is actually much simpler than you might think. You just move the position of the MOSFET. Now, equally, you could scrap the MOSFET entirely and just use a switch in its place. However, I'm planning to integrate this into a future project, which is why I have the MOSFET.
With that all hooked up, it will make sense. I'm going to hit play on a song in a second, but I'm not expecting it to sound great. And the reason for that, I'll get into in a minute. But have a listen to how it sounds now.
Ma'am, I'm going to need you to pay in this cup.
Alright. Penny, pay to my off-wife, Penny. I've been going off on many. Shit, wearing off on many. More on the way, don't penny. Oh, drink too much, goddamn it.
Now, nearly unplugged the mic. Now, the reasoning for this is twofold. Partially, I'm only using 16-bit transmission from this mic to the camera. But the main reason is because I'm only using one speaker, which is good for the low end, as I mentioned earlier. It really struggles with high end though. So we're going to add in a tweeter to fill the gap.
Specifically, this tweeter. Now, if I just plug that into the same signal, I can say with 100% confidence that I will completely shred it. So we're going to use a high pass filter.
For this project, we're going to be using a second order high pass filter, meaning it has two parts, a capacitor and an inductor, and they work in very similar ways. As the frequency increases, the impedance of the capacitor decreases. You can kind of think of it as a resistor, which gets less resistive as frequency increases. An inductor is exactly the opposite. So as the frequency increases, its impedance increases. Basically, this means that the inductor shorts the low frequencies to ground while allowing the high frequencies to continue along the wire.
And now with the high pass filter, I can hit play and the tweeter will make noise.
Shut that door, don't stand it. Shit too loud, can't stand it. I can't stand it. Play it, I didn't end up
it. Hold on.
Careful when you do me wrong. I don't ever chase shit. Life is what you make it. Say that when you make it. How are you gonna turn it up? Why these expectations?
The problem is, it might sound better, but now we have too much top end, because both speakers are making top end. How do we fix this? Well, we use a low pass filter.
A low pass filter works much the same way as a high pass filter, but in reverse. We're actually only using a first order low pass filter here, meaning that it only has one component. This could technically be called an inductive low pass filter. The way this works is you have an inductor here, which, as we know, increases its impedance for higher frequencies. So it allows the lower frequencies to pass through unimpeded to the speaker.
Now I have everything hooked up. I actually made a custom inductor, which sounds super fancy, but it's actually just winding some copper, so super easy. And this sounds fantastic right now. I'll give you a quick play before we actually put everything together.
Can't stop staring at those ocean eyes, burning cities and napalm skies, 15 flares inside those ocean eyes, your ocean.
It's actually so clean that I think it's as good or indistinguishable from the original track. Okay, that's a lie. It probably is distinguishable. But it is the cleanest sounding speaker I've heard pretty much in my life. Let's put it in a box that looks nice.
The first thing to do, though, before we can go any further, is drill out a hole for the tweeter. And in my infinite wisdom, I used an impact driver to do this, which means I basically shattered the wood away rather than nicely drilling. Either way, we ended up with a hole that it fitted in quite nicely. The assembly process was honestly quite boring, so I'm not going to give you too many details. But I did put a piece of acoustic foam in the back to seal any air gaps and make it nice and well-sounding. That's not a very good word. And then 3D printed a black plane, which I fitted in all my components. The charger, the on-off switch, and the voltage reading. I screwed this in place with 3 screws, and, well, the speaker was done.
The speaker is now done. But how does the final product sound?
Well, in order to test that, I have here a UE boom, and we're going to put them head to head using this studio quality mic to see if we can tell a difference in the sound quality. This is already a very high-end Bluetooth speaker,
costing somewhere in the realm of $150. But can our little box actually beat it? Or will it fall short?
Ma'am, I'm gonna need you to pay in this cup.
Alright. Penny, pay to my off-wife, Penny. I've been going off on many. Shit, wearing off on many. More on the way, don't penny. Drink too much, goddamn it. Shut that door, don't slam it. Shit too loud, can't stand it. I can't stand it. Wasted, riding in the basement. Careful when you do me wrong. I don't ever chase it. Life is what you make it.
That comparison was incredible. The Yui Boom is an extremely capable speaker, and mine not only kept up with it, but also sounded better in my subjective opinion. Now for the real question, did I manage to do it cheaper? Luckily, the answer is yes, and I didn't break the bank on this one. The speaker driver itself was about $45. The amplifier was actually free, but you can buy them for around $10 online. The earbuds were a broken pair, which I picked up on eBay for €3. Well, that kind of throws off the comparison, but continuing down the list, the charger, although I salvaged it from another project, only cost $5 for the original project. And the battery, well, that could be made out of 18650 cells. You only need 3 of them. So let's add another $6 there. All up then, this speaker's costing less than half the price of the Yui Boom, which it significantly outperforms. Definitely would recommend this project.